Thank you. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Please do sit down. It's really delightful to be with you this morning. I think I'm still a very new Bishop of Kingston. Some have told me I'm now gone through 1 month. I'm still standing, so that's something. I'm not a complete stranger to Richmond, in that in the early 1990s, I was very lucky to live in my grandfather's flat up a hill, I believe, while he was abroad. It was very luxurious lodging for a student. I look forward to chatting with some of you afterwards and hearing about the life of your churches. We are in the season of Lent, as you know, and today the Gospel reading remembers Nicodemus going to see Jesus at night. So whether by day or by night, I pray for all of us that we may have a profound encounter with Jesus this Lent.
The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord who is full of compassion and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith. Most merciful
God,
Father,
a reading from the book of Genesis. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. So Abraham went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him, was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. What then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh? For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him, who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but to all, also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives the life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
To you, Lord, Creator and Redeemer. Amen. I don't know if you noticed the very last verse from our reading from Paul's letter to the Romans, where Paul speaks of God giving life to the dead and calling into existence the things that do not exist. What an exciting image that is. God calling into existence the things that do not exist. It speaks to me of God's creativity, God's ongoing act of creation. And I hope for all of us it might cast our mind back to creative and exciting times in our own lives when things that did not exist came into existence by God's grace. When you get that sense almost that something came out of nothing, the Latin is ex nihilo, isn't it? The example that comes to my mind relates to when I was living in Vietnam working on my PhD. My wife Mary and I had arrived in Saigon, now Ho Chi Minh City, our youngest Annie barely 2 years old, suitcases in hand, at a time when there were not many foreigners living in Vietnam, to see if we could make a life for ourselves and me to get to work on my PhD on the politics of that country. And I remember thinking, I have a blank sheet of paper to fill with 100,000 words, and I don't even speak the language, speak Vietnamese. But 5 years later, having done battle with the language, I duly did fill that blank sheet of paper. And I felt that I brought into light something about the Communist Party of Vietnam that until that point had been hidden, calling into existence the things that do not exist, profoundly creative and exciting. Thanks be to God and an awful lot of people who helped me along the way. I wonder, in the life of St. Mary's, of St. Matthias and St. John, and the communities you serve, what God, through you, is calling into existence that doesn't currently exist. Perhaps it's not entirely clear. I could never have imagined the riches that God bestowed on me through the experience of researching that PhD. But we can be sure, we can be certain that God is at work in the life of your churches and the communities you serve. We can be sure of that, because that's the kind of God God is, a creator God, bringing into light that which has been hidden. And as I say, I find that incredibly exciting. Nicodemus, in our Gospel reading, a leader of the Jews, a Pharisee, a member of the Sanhedrin, came to see Jesus by night, didn't he? What's going on there? Something's going on. And we get this rather protracted and unsatisfactory conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus about being born from above and being born from the Spirit, where they seem to be talking past each other. Are you a teacher of Israel, Jesus says, and yet you do not understand these things? What's going on? Until recently, I've been in Bristol Diocese, and I had various roles there. But one of the things that I did during my time in Bristol, I was chaplain to a Royal Marine unit. It was very much a ministry of presence, the church being present as soldiers trained for war. I felt very clearly the church should be present, even amid the sadness of conflict in our world, and perhaps representing something of God in their midst. That's how I saw my role as chaplain. The Marines that I ministered to were often in the sort of 18 to 25 year old bracket. They were pleased and somewhat intrigued to have me around, but they didn't want to do too much God talk, it had to be said. But I remember one time on sentry duty at night, when the conversation between myself and a young Royal Marine recruit really flowed, talking about ultimate things, probably in hushed voices, the room was supposed to be quiet, talking about faith. Somehow, in the darkness and the quiet of the night, this was possible in a way that it wasn't during the day. Where that conversation led, I do not know, but I always remember it when the story of Nicodemus comes round. Many of the commentaries suggest that Nicodemus came by night because he feared his social status might be undermined by being associated with Jesus. Maybe. But what else was going on for Nicodemus in that protracted and seemingly rather unsatisfactory conversation with Jesus? What was God, through Jesus, calling into existence here that did not currently exist? And as with Nicodemus, what about ourselves? What's God calling into existence in us? And what about the people that we're in touch with through the week? I know that for myself, a serious commitment of faith was preceded by a strong denial of God. So So perhaps we need to be careful not to be too quick to take denial, hostility, rejection, incomprehension in the people we meet at face value. To be alert to the possibility of an encounter with Jesus, where something is creatively called into existence that does not currently exist. And I like this as a slant on Nicodemus meeting with Jesus, that I'm not sure gets enough airtime, and yet I think it makes sense. Do you recall that Nicodemus appears twice more in John's Gospel? Once more in chapter 7, when he reminds his colleagues, his fellow rabbi in the Sanhedrin, that the law requires that a person be heard before they are judged. And Nicodemus is ridiculed for this. So he's playing an interesting part here. And then finally in chapter 19, Nicodemus appears again, following Jesus' crucifixion, assisting Joseph of Arimathea with Jesus' burial, providing embalming spices in quantities fit for a royal burial, one of the commentaries says. These are not the actions of a man who has dismissed Jesus, surely not. Rather, they speak of a profound encounter which left Nicodemus changed. We will often not know, we won't be around to witness the impact of our words and actions on the people we meet, who may come to us in a literal or a metaphorical light. But as we journey through Lent, let us pray that we can mediate something of Jesus' ability to transform and to heal. And may we be alert to his creativity in the life of St. Mary, St. Mark, Matthias, and St. John, calling into existence that which doesn't currently exist. And let us be excited by that. Thanks be to God.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things are made,
Creator God, this morning we welcome with open hearts and arms our brother, Bishop Martin Gainsborough, the new Bishop of Kingston. Shall we give him a clap? We pray for him and Mary and his family as he embarks on this new challenge in his life. Bishop Martin comes to us to forward God's mission for our local clergy, for the flourishing of our parishes and our schools. In this blessed place of Richmond, may he forward his mission for the environment, foster interfaith relations, and encourage those seeking confirmation and ordination. We give thanks for the ministry of Bishop Richard and wish him well for his further journey. Lord, in your mercy, hear your prayer. Creator God, in this time of Lent, we take stock of where we are as Christians and seek to draw nearer to you and to be reconciled with you through forgiveness. We thank you for sending your Son to guide us into a better relationship with ourselves, our neighbours, and with you. May your Holy Spirit sustain our endeavours. We lift our eyes to the hills, from where is our help to come? From you, dear Lord. We pray for our young people seeking confirmation at this time, and we rejoice in the gift of baptism. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We hold before you our church. We pray for those who lead our communities. Bishop Christopher, Bishop Martin, Wilma, Anne and Charlie, and hopefully for the newly appointed priest at St. John's. And we pray for all who forward our common good. May our church always be open, inclusive, and welcoming community, where all are valued and included, and none are excluded. Lord God, you gave your only Son that everyone who believes in you should not perish, but have eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we pray for our fractured world, for our sisters and brothers in Ukraine as they bravely struggle for justice, for the 740 Ukrainians being hosted here in Richmond. May our generosity continue. We pray for the people of Turkey and of Syria, devastated by recent earthquakes. We pray for Afghanistan, Iran and Yemen. And we do not forget the boat people crossing the seas in small rubber dinghies. Please, Lord, help us to bring an equitable, just and fair solution to these situations. We pray for those in positions of power in this world. May your wisdom enter their hearts. May they think of their citizens' welfare before their own preferment. We give thanks for the diligence of the Prime Minister and his advisers in forwarding the Windsor framework, and we pray it may find accord in Northern Ireland and elsewhere. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we pray for those who are mourning loved ones. We pray for those who are sick and for their carers, the homeless, the helpless, the marginalised, and all who suffer in body, mind and spirit. We pray for Charles and Sherwin, for Susie and Mark, for Nick and Sue. and we pray for Ellen and Paul here today in our hearts. We pray for all who need our prayers. Help them in your loving presence as we pray for them this morning. Lord, in your mercy. Dear Lord, we give thanks for children, grandchildren, for family and friends. Bless all children, the children of our church, and as we pray for each other and ourselves, may we shine as a light in the world for the glory of God the Father. Amen. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Lord, those who have prayed in our church over 800 years are always part of our communion. In 1939, Patricia Ann Parsons was baptized on this day. And in 1838, Robert Harper and Margaret Stone were married. Today, we honour the special memory of Arthur Warden and of Barry Snail Adams, much loved and much missed, whose funerals took place on the 5th of March in 2004 and 2012, and we give thanks for their lives well lived. Merciful God, accept the prayer of the saints of the Father, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
We offer one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Thank you.
It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ your Son. For in these 40 days you lead us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer, and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with angels and saints forever praising you and saying, until he comes in glory.
Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes, and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people, gather us in your loving arms, and bring us with all the saints to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us.
Who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
And we say together,
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
I get the best job in the world, don't I? The notices. Can I, on behalf of all of us, say to Bishop Martin how wonderful it is to have you with us. We're so glad you've come home. Well, a little bit of home. If you've lived up the hill, then Richmond is home, isn't it?
Yes.
Definitely. Do please stay after this service for refreshments. There is coffee and tea. There's also juice. And if you're not that strict about it, there may even be a glass of wine. So please stay, not just to drink those things, but to have a chance to greet each other and to say hello to Bishop Martin and to make him feel really welcome in our church and in this team. May I add a few other things to the notices? Don't forget that there is evensong this evening, and the anthem fits in very well with the gospel reading you heard this morning. So please remember that. And then on Wednesday, we continue our series of Lent lectures on matters of social justice. And this time we'll be thinking about poverty as a matter of social justice. It is warmly recommended to you. I hope you will join us 7:30 on Wednesday. There was one other note. Yes, I know. There was one other notice in my head. Many of you have been praying very hard for the appointment of a new vicar at St. John's. I'm afraid I can't tell you anything yet. So would you please be really kind, particularly to Mary and to other people who are involved in the interview process. Don't ask us just yet. We will be able to say something soon, but not today. So if you have been praying, don't give up yet. Keep praying, and then in due course we will let you know the good news, because there will always be good news. I hope that's okay with all of you, and I'm sure that will help Mary enormously as church warden, not to be asked by everybody. Thank you very much for that, but thank you also for your support. It has really been very important. And we certainly felt that we were surrounded by lots of prayers on Wednesday as we met with the candidates. We now stand for our final hymn, and then we receive God's blessing.
Thank you.
follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all whom you love, and remain with you always. Amen.